Yeah, a packed house here for this match, and they are right on the button, Anders. This could potentially be a grand final match right here. It seems like we have the top two teams in the world about to face off in a best of three, and whoever takes this, they're looking pretty damn good to take the whole thing.
DreamHack Winter 2014 was the third and final major of the year. The French in LDLC and the Swedes of Fnatic entered the tournament as the two favorite teams to win.
Facing Fnatic was obviously something special. We were the two big teams at that point, and after losing several times against them in big moments, ESWC especially, in front of our home crowd, that was something special. So we just wanted to prove them that we are competitive, that we can beat them.
LDLC and Fnatic all year had been kind of culminating to this moment, to this tournament, this matchup. Fnatic had brought in two players from LGB. They brought in Krims, and they brought in Olaf Meister. And then LDLC, there was their own French shuffle that happened earlier in the year. These two teams had actually played each other in two grand finals leading up to this, at ESWC and at Fragbite Masters. Fnatic took both of them, but like no one really worried about it too much, just because with this newer roster that LDLC had, everyone was looking at this major saying, this is where they're going to come in top form. This is where this matchup is really going to matter.
This is potentially, I said it on Twitter, I still stand by it, this could be the best series of the year because of the history of these two teams. They're both peaking in terms of like amazing form, still going on all the maps. So this series right here, if you're new to Counter-Strike and maybe you just only watched some of the games, you've seen a few good games, you've seen some games that were stomps, this is potentially, every map can go the whole distance. There's no real, like, this is our map, this is their map. This could be like the highest level CSGO we've ever seen. So just like buckle in, this is going to be a good one.
While LDLC made it out first in their group, Fnatic finished second due to an early loss to Hellraisers, notorious for upsetting group stage matches.
To put things in perspective as well, if Fnatic didn't lose versus Hellraisers yesterday, they would have taken Hellraisers' spot. They would have played Fnatic or NIP in the quarters, and then you would have the bracket that we were kind of looking for.
Yeah.
You know, we could have potentially had Fnatic LDLC in the grand final. But since Fnatic lost, they got stuck with LDLC. And potentially we have, like Thorin was saying, probably the best game of the event in the quarterfinal.
Facing Fnatic that early in the tournament was not really expected, but it was something we didn't really have a choice against. They ended up second into the group stage, and that's not the first time it happened. Like, either we or they did bad games in group stages, and then we ended up facing early into the tournament. So we felt like it was kind of a chance to play them earlier, because when those guys are coming into a grand final, they're a completely different beast. They're reaching the grand final and they're not losing.
When we got up the seed draw against LDLC, we were like, of course, we're going to end up against the best team in the whole tournament. It pretty much was either us or them who was going to win the tournament. So we were like, this is unlucky, but since we've beaten them all the other times, why not do it now as well?
Finally, there was no more waiting. The battle would happen on Dust 2, Cash and Overpass. And the stage was set for an epic match.
The thing is, like, when we play against Fnatic, the main point is to be perfect. We knew every time we face them, we have to play perfectly. So if we don't, they're gonna wreck us.
So here we have it, guys. We're about to load into the pistol round of the first half. Fnatic starting on the defense, LDLC on the offense, but he is close, and they are all so low on Fnatic right now. Krims instantly taken out. Long range shot there from the CZ, and Flush against Dropthought.
Should definitely save these three rifles, but it's not going to be possible. Chronix goes down, coming for all of Meister here. They jump down. That's the answer that Fnatic have right now for the Frenchman. And Smiths, he's going to come out on top. Sees a map where Smiths has a really uncanny ability. Jorby takes down Olaf Meister as well. Living it short and long. Great shot from Olaf Meister. Goes for a second one. He's got backup. Retake this grenade. It could be a touchdown all the way in the back. Goodbye, Smith.
Set up, and JW is running out of time. He's got a kid to work with, but it is not going to be good enough here. As soon as he rounds the corner, Shox is waiting, and there's the headshot to end the first half.
The thing with LDLC, or that's where actually after that tournament they got the nickname LDLCZ. That's where the team got their fame for being really, really good at winning force buys. And in that particular game map on Dust 2, they were actually able to win three rounds where they force bought or even were on an eco with just having pistols. So really, that was the turning point of the game.
Krims picking up a good triple. Nice shot with the CZ75. Great shot from Sharks. Now they're coming here. Fnatic, they need to get in, but Sharks drops the bomb. Yes, this is dangerous, and Smith Strawhawk pulls out the pistol. He doesn't even care about the AWP, takes him down. MBK down there, gonna run out of bullets, and they're gonna come and hunt him down. JW with a good kill, Happy charging in. Protector's gonna get shot in the face long distance there. Just missing a couple of them, and Hiroshima's gonna take him down. There. Oh, but they're coming in, they're smashing their way through. Great work from LDLC. MBK down here picks up two, has the pistol out, goes for their shot. Grimms is gone. MBK steals the AKM. Happy decides to pick up, and he gets him mid-air. That's bomb site, though. Smith's all the way in the background, and we've been hyping him up. JW, he gets us the angle off.
This kill is going to be crucial, but it looks like Holofmeister just barely stays alive. Hiroshima, in the meantime, he's got the scar 20. Surprise, surprise, gets two, makes it three. And this is it. It's about to be lights out for Fnatic. There isn't a whole lot of hope for Holofmeister with one HP.
Going into the first map and coming out of the first map, it really felt it. What you had learned, essentially, when dealing with Fnatic is that they were like this beast that always, like, what could we do? It was like a Leviathan. No, it wasn't a Leviathan. What was it? The Hydra, exactly. You cut off one head, and you're like, oh, I cut off one head, I cut off one map. But then two maps come out afterwards, and they win the best of three.
It was pretty expected, because Dust2 at that point was a French map, where French teams were just good on that map. Whether it was Titan at that point of time, or us, we're just playing great there on that map.
LDLC does exactly what they need to do. It is their map choice. And again, 16-10. There you have it.
That's the first time that's ever happened, though. Every single time these two teams have played with these lineups, map one always goes to Fnatic. The only map LDLC's ever won against them was the third map in a best of five where LDLC were already down 0-2. So they've never put Fnatic on the back foot.
The first map is won by LDLC, but this is often where the Fnatic lineup is the most terrifying. With their backs to the wall, they have but one way forward.
But you can tell the way that they were playing on Dust2, LDLC, they're confident. Coming into cash now as well, they can still win cash.
We've never seen them like that as well against Fnatic.
Exactly.
They have a really strong CT half, so if they can just put up like 9-10 rounds, the pressure's going to really be on Fnatic at that
especially
point.
Especially being one map down.
No, that's the point, because they'll know, like, if we mess up here, it's over already.
Yeah.
And so then it can be a quick 2-0.
Their players had different strengths, and they complemented each other so well. JW, in 2014, he was one of the best players, and because of his very, very aggressive play style, again, it would look even silly at times from the outside, but he was able, probably the only player who was able to make it work, and that opened so many options for his team. You have Flasha, who is, I think, still the best rated player at majors, so when it comes to those biggest tournaments, could always rely on him to perform, a very intelligent player, someone again very good at clutch situations. So they were across the board a very calm and collected team. You would never see them crumble under pressure. They would always rise up to the task.
Playing against LDLC, we never was actually like worried about one player in particular. We never like had that mindset that we need to shut this player down. Well, we always went into a game like just playing our own game, and we didn't think about who we played.
Every player could be the best player in the whole world at that game. We always know that Flasher could be the best player in the world, I could be the best player in the world, all of Crims. Pronox could also have really, really good games where he have very, very high impact. I think that was the unique thing in our team at that point, that it didn't matter what game or what time, anybody could show up and be the best player in the world.
This is going to be a very quick push onto the B side, but LDLC are pushing it as well. This is fantastic. Do they spot it first? Yes, Shoxi gets the first headshot. Fnatic round the corner, but nobody is there.
In the middle and flush us over a bit.
Fnatic only really need to have five rounds or so on their T side. Hello, Crims.
There's a reason we picked cash after all, and it's because we kick ass on it.
MBK will follow up with a kill. He's playing this forklift area really well and picks up Crims as well and does a lot of damage to all of my students.
And this is the shot. He catches him with the wrong gun in hand.
Jumps over on from Electric, and JW's going to come out here. They both miss. CSET 75 is going to finish off Shoxi. Now it is a 2-on-2. And another jump. JW Shox should be going down. 11-4 for the first half here. It's a monstrous result for Fnatic.
Fnatic on cash was very good, and even closing out rounds very early on, like more than a minute left on the timer, and they would still pick a site and hit it as a unit, and that's where their strengths really lied. Fnatic winning cash, they were helped a little bit by LDLC, because they were, you know, famous for those force buys and how they can make it work, but also notorious for how they would overdo it at times.
Gonna be up to Crims, his map's so huge. He picks up the one, gets the double, goes for another one. Crims going big, 8 seconds left. He wants that quad, he's not gonna get it. Here is gonna be the absolute key difference.
Right there, Shanxi not quite able to find the angle to clear Crims out of this position. Go in a prime position to cut them in half. It's going to be Shanxi to light one up. McFlusso is there as well, and this works perfectly for Fnatic to put them on map point.
Alright, he's got this perfectly figured out. Very nice way here to end. As he gets a headshot, 16-8, and Fnatic bring us on to a third round.
We were obviously extremely confident into our map, and they were extremely confident into theirs. And at that point, we didn't really break the cash meta game where we would know what was going on and exactly how to counter them or how we would find our pace. Yeah, it was kind of expected to reach a third map, especially against Fnatic, where we were probably the two best teams at that point of time.
That was Fnatic's from the get-go, basically really nicely done by them, did exactly what
much
they needed
like
to do.
Much like at the end there, you saw LDLC eating some donuts. Well, it was kind of a hole, it felt like, in the defense of LDLC, and Fnatic ate them up like a delicious little treat, and they were like, more please.
It is important to note, once we start talking about Overpass, that map was just introduced a couple of months prior, before the ESL Cologne Major, so teams were still figuring it out.
Overpass at the time was very CT-sided. The layout is completely different than we see it now. As a CT team, you really didn't need to be aggressive. You didn't need to move towards bathrooms whatsoever. I mean, teams tried it once in a while, but I mean, with teams not really knowing and understanding how it worked at that point in time, because it was still very new, most teams just sat back, and LDLC was great at this style. They sat back out of the site and they just played behind smokes during executions, and they were just extremely good at defense. But I mean, every team, this was just one of the most CT-sided maps we had in the rotation.
Now remains only Overpass. The series is tied, and the LDLC lineup have a mountain to climb if they want to stay alive in the tournament.
It's a good thing that LDLC is starting on the CT side, because I know for a fact when they get pummeled like this, you know, they never had a chance on cash. If they would have started T-side and, you know, they didn't get any rounds at all, and coming from that loss on cash, it would have been over.
The defense is going to be brutal, because the way this site works, it's one single choke point to get into it, and Fnatic would all have to run through. But they are going to use some of these nades now, Fnatic, and this could potentially set up a fake. I mean, they have the bomb close, but they aren't all here.
No, I think you're right. This is going to be a fake. They're just making sure that no one's on the rest of the map. They do get the early kill on JW, which is good, but they need to worry about the speed bomb sign. And actually, LDLC are still here. They haven't moved an inch, which is great news for the French team. NBK putting out some shots. Happy's missing too. What's going on? Finally, they get the kill, and NBK gets a chance to reload. The bomb is going to go down at the very least here for the Fnatic team. But now, the cavalry has arrived, and it's LDLC charging the bomb site. No one's died yet on the CT side. Crims trying with the burst fire, but it's a flawless round for LDLC.
The early game appears even between the two teams, but it isn't long before LDLC ignite, and for the rest of the half, they appear to reach a level that nobody thought possible.
And they're going to be able to put it down at the very least. Olofmeister is now using that container to try and hide. It's going to be down to Shock. It goes for the kill. There's a little position on the other side, and Flusher can't make the crossover. Takes the first two coming in. No scope. Headshot, and a return. JW coming in here with the AK, looking for the opening, but Chucks will take him down. It's now a 2-on-3. The bomb not even going to go down.
Actually, I don't really remember what LDLC did that was so good against us. We just struggled at the T side.
For LDLC on Overpass, that was when really Shocks, stepped up for his team in those aggressive moves. He was the one leading the way, getting a lot of openings. Happy as well with the AWP towards the B bomb site, again was able to shut Fnatic down. So when they started with the aggressive playstyle on the CT side is really when they managed to overcome Fnatic.
He's already got the triple kill, and he just needs one more. Getting the quad, sealing the round here would be such a big deal. Happy, he's got a smoke. If he puts it off on this side, Pronax is going to be in a tough position. He smokes the bomb instead, fakes it once, runs out right at the edge, and he gets the kill. Oh, Happy! A stunning performance from him.
When we reached 12-3, we were very confident about. I mean, we're not 100% confident, but we're pretty confident. We said, yeah, that's probably the best half we've ever done against them, ever.
And if you look at the Fnatic scoreboard, nobody on the Fnatic side is above 9 kills. 8 is the most currently on Pronex, but everyone is, you know, sub 9. And that's a problem when you see that Shox and Happy are dropping 17, MBK at 16 kills. It is really terrifying at the moment here. Make a little bit of noise for Fnatic. I think they need it here, DreamHack. They are on the home turf anyway, and I think right now, more than anything, they're gonna need to simply win this pistol. And they are playing a pretty standard game, although, do they have a weird boost going on currently? Yes,
look at this boost!
Oh my god,
this is beautiful.
He can look over to the restrooms as well! This is Pronex being a genius. They did warn us that they had been planning something, and it's almost painful to see that it doesn't work out the way they wanted it to. That's very clever.
But LDLC have no idea. I mean, they're gonna be able to use that in gun rounds. That is huge. Now, do Fnatic have enough bodies on the site to stop this push?
Flusher here, he's gonna put up a quick grenade here, follow up as well, but he's just being charged down. It's a good follow up headshot there. Pronex will be able to take down Smith, but Flusher falls. LDLC, they are powering their way through into this bomb site. Quick bomb plant as well, and then they instantly escape. All of Meister catch you, one kill as they try and fall out of the bomb site. But Fnatic, they need to get in here quick. They have to retake this. They can't let this go, and Kirishima goes down. It's Shox and MBK left. They are gonna have to fight their way back to prevent the defuse from happening. MBK down on the wrap, and there's the kill. Shox comes in with another one here, and it's gonna be a one on two. He just has to defend. It's a one headshot. He needs to pick up a second one, and he's gonna get it. Double kill. LDLC, they win the round.
We were down 13-2 or something like that, and we planned to save it as long as possible and use it if we had to, basically, because we, why not? And yeah, we were down 13-2 and said, like, okay, now is the chance to just try it out, like, and it worked great, so.
Olafmeister again is boosted up here, looking all the way over with the scout in hand, but this is incredible. I mean, for Fnatic to not get this boost working in the pistol round, having this is like your ace up the sleeve, basically, and then everybody just falls on the round. Nobody going to play the hand at all. That's terrifying. LDLC looking immensely strong right now.
They're avoiding that part of the map right now, LDLC. They really haven't gone through. The first man into that sort of into that part is going to be Shoxy, but he doesn't even show himself. And what I'm wondering is, do LDLC have the info?
Oh.
No, there we go.
Follow Meister. He's not seeing them. I have no idea why. I think he must have been looking at somebody else's monitor just in that second. It can't get worse than this, surely. Olafmeister is still waiting. The patience game coming out. He can spot them coming out of squeak door as well. He's here. He sees them down there. Straight headshot. They have no idea. Smith's looking confused and dazed, and there's going to be a follow-up headshot. Olafmeister, you've got to be kidding me. Takes down Kirishima as well. Oh, it finally works. And now Fnatic, if this is the comeback moment for them, this will be absolute history in Counter-Strike. It's Smith's taken down next. JW, the bomb is down, yes, but it's a 5-on-2. Shox trying to keep it alive here for LDLC. And Happy will do a fine job in there, but it is the return. Fnatic, they pick up the round. The boost works. And that's going to be it. Beautiful.
When we first saw the boost, I just didn't understand. Like, I didn't, like, I think there was a moment where it takes a while to dawn on you, but I just at that moment, I realized this is completely and utterly over. Everything culminated for that boost to just be perfect for Fnatic, right? Everything worked out so that that boost could just be unbelievably powerful for them and turn things their way.
It's teamwork. It's real teamwork that allows for this. It's a triple man boost.
This is so cheeky. Oh, it's hard not to love what Fnatic are doing right here. LDLC, they just lost the round to it, and they still are not sure. They're just getting fired at. They're going down. Olafmeister, they have no idea. This has got to be frustration on a whole new level. Pronex taking another kill down here, and it's Happy alone in a 1-on-4, and he's going to roll. JW makes it work. It's now 5-13. The crowd is absolutely fired up here.
When we used the boost, I guess we were laughing a lot during the match, and like, I guess Olaf, he felt like a god, I guess, but we were more laughing about how they, like, it felt like LDLC was just running around like headless chicken. They They didn't know what was happening. And for us it was kind of bizarre that they didn't figure it out.
We actually never played it against an opponent. We just went through it and it was like, okay, we don't need to practice this. This is insane. It's very, very good. And we need to save this for a moment where we really, really need it. We thought it would work for maybe one or two rounds, but that is something I think we would have learned if we used it on practice. We would have learned that it will work for the entire half pretty much. So we didn't know how good it really was. We just know that it could be very, very good.
It's happening again.
It's happening again. Let's see. I mean, do they give it away? Do they use it here? I mean, he hasn't even shown that he can use it towards top mid like this. Fnatic, I mean, LDLC could run right through here. They may have never. Wait, are they jumping around trying to check?
No, I think he's just jumping. There it is. All of that is raining down death from above. He's essentially just a god picking people out. Look at this field of view. He might as well be in a helicopter above the map at this point, just sniping people.
This is
cruel and unusual punishment, without a doubt, from Olafmeister.
We don't have time to try to figure out what is going on. Let's just try to counter it and to see how we can beat them and how we can adapt to that if Sewer is not safe anymore. So you don't really have time to think too much into what is going on, but more what are the solutions? How can we counter that with our game and how we play? I mean, there was not really a lot of things to say because, like, when you have 50% of the map that is just cancelled for a team to work on, it's pretty hard to build stuff around that.
It was really overpowered, the amount of information solely you get. Even if you don't get any kills, what it allows you to do, the rotations you can make based off of that, it really was insane, the impact the boost had.
So we'll be confused, and we took a timeout at some point to manage to find where it was coming from and find, like, a counter to this.
I don't think the crowd is helping LDLC much right now either.
No, they're being taunted here. This is Sweden and Fnatic. Well, they got to be feeling pretty excited about that.
So during the timeout, I remember it was a pretty special moment because we all took off our headsets and we gathered around, I mean, the center of the desk, which was around Happy. And so we just started discussing, yeah, okay, we cannot figure out what it is, how they kill us. So that was already a pretty weird part because nobody really knew where he was and which area he could cover. We could just suppose, yeah, okay, he can kill us in 2 hours and he can see whenever we're coming banana or toilet. So we're just supposing, so we're like, yeah, okay, the 2-3 areas are gonna be through long or through monster. And so that was pretty much the two working points we had to make something work. And that was very thin, especially in against such a good team that can adapt and play well against you. So it was mostly, let's try to work in those areas and see whatever we can do, or just play fast-paced tactics that we were using at that point of time, just packed. But they were ready for that because they only had those areas to cover. So, yeah, the tactical timeout was just, let's try to focus on those points and let's try to win those rounds.
We are live here in the 27th round. LDLC with a force of their own here. Galil's and AK, very limited nades. They hardly have any at all to speak of. And Olafmeister, he may just give it away here.
Oh, grenade out. Not going to do too much damage, but down in Super is MVP going down. The pain continues. Fnatic might take the round lead for the first time on this map if they can just
figure it out. Yoshima now knows. Yoshima knows the position. That shot there from Olafmeister gave it away. Now they know. Now the game is up. LDLC know where he is. They're trying to find the angle, but it's so brutal. Olafmeister can't quite hit the shot either.
Now, look at this. Smith spies a sniper, and we need to be watching Smiths at all times here. We need to see if they can stop Olafmeister. It's been an incredible amount of rounds in the row here. It's been almost unreal. And he is walking around the other side of the map.
Yes. Now, does he actually find an angle with the boost over on long? Is that going to be a good enough angle?
Happy's over here trying to shoot at him, so they've definitely found different ways of shooting at Olafmeister. He took a little bit of damage there, so yeah, they are starting to figure it out, but you can't help but feel it might be be way, way, way too late here for LDLC.
That's going to be the question. Flash will lead the way. Smith is there for the entry, but he's not going to get it. Crims from the back of the site is going to line them up. He instantly gets taken out by Kirishima, but Kirishima gives them a helping hand and takes out Shox in the mix. We're into a 3-on-3 now, and Olfmeister is here with the Star 20. Peeks out Kirishima, takes him out of the fight, and NBK now exposed for the barbecue, but Flesha gets the job done, and it's all down to Happy, who's been sneaking up all along, and this is the brilliant play! It's all He tries to get all three, but he gets one and a half instead, and Happy is going to be shattered after that play.
They are trying to figure out the angle once again here. They're trying to see if they could potentially get a cleaner shot. Look at this. Now Happy getting boosted up, but he gets spotted. Olfmeister sees it coming. They've accounted for this, Fnatic. They're one step ahead. They know where they can get spotted from. They know the weaknesses of their play, and it looks like Happy, much to his dismay, has found that out just now. LDLC now down a man. Tournament, or not tournament point, not yet, but feels like it. Quarterfinal point here on the line. A spot in the semis, and Fnatic are in a fantastic position.
Grenade raining out. Does a little bit of damage onto Shox there. This is it for LDLC, and Olofmeister will pick up the kill on Shox. Just shooting and running with the auto sniper. The end is near. It's 5-on-3, and Fnatic have summoned an unbelievable comeback. They pull up an ace out the sleeve, and they do it for just every single round. They're on out. Flesha gets the double, and it's down to Smith. No chance at all. Fnatic, they make their way to the semis of another major tournament here. Pronax with a final kill. 16-13.
The crowd in Sweden actually loved it. Like, everyone was cheering after the game. Like, I think probably 100 people came up to me and said, like, this is the best game I have ever seen, and sold it to the whole team. So we felt like gods.
I remember that right after the game ended, everyone was not even sad coming at us, and they were just showing up, showing to us their phones and showing to us the boost, how it got made, and like, yeah, this is broken. There's no way it can be allowed into a competitive game. And so it was pretty weird because we were all crushed, like we just lost, we're almost in tears. I mean, it was just like such a big moment for us.
Something like this had never really been seen before in a long time of Counter-Strike, even dating to previous versions. I think a lot of the reasons why the public got so upset and even more upset as the game went on was no one really stopped to look at it from Fnatic's viewpoint, that this was just like some very good advantage, something very clever that they found. And if you were on social media during this match, like everyone was just marinating in each other's hate. They just like stewed in it for the entirety of this second half, where everyone's anger at the situation just increased everyone else's anger just over and over again.
Thank you very much, Scott. I am here with Devil. I'm speechless, honestly. When did you guys find that?
I think it was 2 months ago.
And you've been saving it until now?
Yeah. It was a beautiful...
I am genuinely speechless. Like, have you got any more up your sleeve, I suppose, is the question? Is there? I suppose, don't give me specifics, obviously, because you're not going to do that, but... If you found that 2 months ago, is there others that we haven't seen yet?
I mean, not to that degree.
The look on your face says yes. Sorry I interrupted you then. People on Reddit have said I shouldn't interrupt you then, but the look on your face says yes.
I mean, the map is called Olaf Pass for a reason.
Honestly, I don't know. I am genuinely speechless. It's made me so upset that... Because it is complete. Do you think it's fair?
I mean, I feel sorry for the LDLC guys because they played an amazing match. They played way better than we actually did, but we had more knowledge about the map, so we won because of that.
Right after the match happens, Devilwalk, who gives an interview where he just comes off very smug and very arrogant. And I think he comes off like that because obviously Devilwalk... at the time didn't know that there was any real problem. They thought this boost was completely legal. They thought there was nothing that they were doing that was wrong. So Devilwalk has no idea what's been going on for the last 45 minutes on social media, between players, between fans and the community. And everyone looking at it from the other direction just says, you know, what an asshole. And it's unfortunate because Devilwalk is not like that in real life whatsoever. He doesn't come off that way in any sense. He's one of the nicest guys I've actually ever spoken to at events. So it's very, very interesting how just everyone, it's that hive mind, right, of the community. Everyone hopping on that bandwagon of disliking Fnatic at the time was kind of the cool thing to be doing.
The insane thing is, I kind of, in a weird way, I respect them.
Yeah.
Think about how tempted they must have been during those 2 months
to use it,
to just use it on this map.
Sure.
Should we use it on this? We're starting to lose this one, slipping away. Should we? No, save it for the major. And if someone had found that a week before online, they'd be like, oh, we could have used it all. But they kept their patience, and somehow, not only did they get overpass, but then they were on CT second, and the whole everything, unfortunately for LDLC, it wasn't just Fnatic's choice, that all these things had to come together at the same time. I thought it was the second map, they might still be in the series, and we go into three maps, you know? All these unfortunate things had to come together at the same time, and at the worst possible moment, because this was the time, based on how it was going, they were gonna beat Fnatic.
We discovered that the match was under review right after the match was finished. The admin, Lil Roban, came up to us and said, like, LDLC has made a protest and we need to process this protest. But he also said, like, but we saw the boost and the boost is perfectly legal, so you can go back to the hotel and chill, but we need to process this protest anyway. So we thought, like, okay, we're through. The boost is legal. We went to the hotel. And just like, yeah, we thought we won the game.
And so it was just confusion at first. And after we saw it, it took us like 1 hour to realize that maybe something is wrong. Maybe it should not have happened, or maybe. And yeah, it was pretty weird at that point when we first saw the boost, because, I mean, all the repercussions and like the persons, what they said, the community, what was their answer to what happened. So it was a very weird moment.
It just seemed like the tournament organizers were looking for a way out, and the eventual result was, after hours of demo review, is they found that both Smith's and Olafmeister's boost took advantage or were subject to this one texture bug that could be applied to both of them. And so they'd found their way to just say, both of you are at fault, actually, and so we'll replay.
It's not an exploit. It's in the rules that you can use this boost. It's not considered an exploit. It's clever use of mechanics.
The ruling wasn't because of a pixel boost or anything like that. The ruling was that you could do a tower, I believe, at like balloons or something, where you could see the guy at the tower, but you couldn't kill him. So the ruling was that he was immortal. And also it was like you could, if you had a scoped weapon, you can zoom into like the bushes, I believe, and you could see like some glitches to T-spawn, something that nobody used to clarify, which was actually the same case for LDLC's boost. They had a boost on car, only two people though. And you could tower on balloons, I believe, and see their head as well and not kill them. So their boost was also illegal due to immortal. So both teams got, not disqualified, but both teams broke the rules pretty much, which ended up in the decision being replay with 0-0.
While Fnatic refused a replay of the match, the dispute was already settled by their forfeit. But the scandal had already set the community on fire with anger and hatred.
It's kind of sad because that game, I think, could have been legendary without those boosts. And it kind of ruined it, because to me it was one of the greatest moments of Counter-Strike, that tournament.
Fnatic in particular was unreal, the level of hate that they were getting for what they had done, from LDLC fans, from everybody else. I mean, there was a lot of baggage on that team coming into it. They were obviously the team to beat coming into it as well, and so you have a lot of people who are cheering to see the Kings dethroned, and any little thing that comes up they're going to jump on, and this was a pretty big thing, right? So, you know, the perfect opportunity to completely destroy those players had come up, and a lot of people took advantage of that.
The community backlash and the pressure some of us felt during that time was insane. Like when we played at the arena, it was like the best feeling I have ever had during a game. I think the best feeling any of us have had during a game, because the fans, the crowd, they were shouting our names. They were like, it was a huge, huge, insane feeling at that point. And then after the game, when we won, everybody wants high fives, like, congratulate us. Then we pick up our phones like, oh shit, this wasn't good. And the community was against us, everybody hated us, like, people were thinking about quitting and giving up, and like, it's not worth it, everybody hates us. So at that point it was like, no matter what we do in the game, like in the replayed game, we will end up as losers. We felt like so. We took the decision that the best thing is that they move on. Our boost was more brutal than there was, so they can move on to play the tournament. I guess that was the most natural feeling at that point.
Looking back at that tournament, it's still my most beautiful victory on Counter-Strike. Not gonna say by far, because we've won a second major like 1 year after that, but this is by far the tournament where we have been tested. We've been pushed to our limits, really, by two Swedish teams that were supported by their home crowd. And for us, it's accepted. We accepted that we've won that game against Fnatic. The only side that I'm unhappy about is that how in a way me and part of my team had to use the community to pressure the organizers, or pressuring Valve to talking to Fnatic or the tournament organizers. I think it is a sad part of that we had to do that in order to have kind of a fair judgment. And that's something I look back at it and I'm not really proud of it, because the Fnatic team, although it gave them that sphere where they were like super united as a team after that, because they had all the community criticizing them, I think it's something that I don't like. I don't want players to be, I want rivalry. I want teams to face against each other and to have something special, one against another. But I don't want the community to look down at teams, because in the end, all the professional players are humans, and they're persons, and they should be looked up to as persons that worked hard and that gave a lot from their lives to be professional players. And people tend to forget that at some point, especially the community. So it's something that even like it was, I don't know, 2, 3, 4, 5 months after that, we were not especially proud about. And yeah, especially me, because that's not the image I want to give to newcomers that have a team that, yeah, they try to trick the whole Counter-Strike community by bringing a boost and breaking the game, and that's the only downside that I look at this story. But aside from that, I still look at the boost as something that should not have happened in Counter-Strike, and it should not have been pride of using it or something like that.